you're so aware of others' feelings. That
what the hell are you doing?
Just slam me when he says some shit like that.
There he is, Bob Dole. Wow, look at that. Holy mackerel. Oh, man. What an honor to see you, sir.
Thank you. Good. Got my casual look on here. How do you like it? Wearing a suit.
You look fantastic, Mr. Dole. And you don't look a day over 85 in person, I got to tell you. You look great.
And let me tell you something. I've traveled all around this country, and I've met the people of America, and I learned one thing about them.
What is that?
I don't like them.
Yeah, they're not great people.
They're damn fools, most of them.
What about your age? I mean, you're older than everyone. Isn't that true?
Age will not be a factor in this election. I'll let you know that right now, Howard Stern.
Age will not be a factor in this
well,
election.
Unless I die.
Right, okay.
Won't be a factor.
Of course, this is the great Norm MacDonald from Saturday Night Live who does Bob Dole so well. And he's made up. He's fully made up as Bob Dole.
I can't do impressions.
No, man, I love you.
I can do him and I can do Ed Sullivan.
Let me see that.
It's Ed Sullivan teaching a class.
All right, go ahead.
Okay, this is Ed Sullivan,
all right.
But he's teaching a grade 4 class.
All right,
okay?
Go ahead.
It's class, today we have a... I can't do the voice.
Right, go ahead.
But it's so
okay, class, today we have a really big quiz.
That's good. That is really good.
The famous Jeopardy bit.
Yes, Jeopardy sketch.
Where you play Burt Reynolds.
Yes.
That thing was one of the most popular sketches. And you pitched the Jeopardy thing.
The reason I really did it is I wanted to do Burt Reynolds. Now, Lauren Michaels, when it came time to do the sketch, I went down and I saw my wardrobe. And, you know, there was a white beard and a bald white cap. And I went, no. I wanted to do Burt Reynolds from 1972.
Right.
And it's funny to be that, but no one ever mentioned it. No one ever mentioned that one guy on Celebrity Jeopardy is from 40 years ago.
Yeah, how could you be Burt Reynolds? It didn't even matter. It didn't occur to anyone.
I met Burt Reynolds, though, which was an amazing...
Was he pissed? Because he doesn't have a big sense of humor, does he?
No, he was real nice to me, and he told me really funny stories. He told me he was in Deliverance, you know, which I loved. You know, he said, I used to do my own gags. Gags, I guess, are like stunts. He was a stuntman.
Yeah.
And so he said, they had this gag where I went over a waterfall. So he says, I'll do the fall. We don't need a stuntman. Frankenheimer says, no, we need a stuntman. He goes, nah, we don't want that, you know?
Yeah.
Frankenheimer says, okay, well, we'll just use a dummy. We'll just throw a dummy over. And he goes, no. So Frankenheimer's idea was just to throw a dummy over. And Burt Reynolds said, no, absolutely, I'm going to do it myself. So Burt Reynolds says he does it. He said his shoulder immediately hit a rock, then his head hit another rock.
Oh, God.
And then he said, the next thing you remember, he's way downstream. All his clothes had been torn off him. And he looked up, and he was just like in shock, right? The next thing he remembers, he's waking up in a hospital. Yeah. John Frankenheimer is at his bedside. And he goes, then I said to John, how'd it look, you know, on the daily? And John Frankenheimer said it looked like a dummy falling off a block.
You are the shining light on Saturday Night Live. The best part of Saturday Night Live is when you do the news.
Right.
So why did they fire you? How did they fire you? How did they tell you they're firing you? Tell me everything.
Well, it was like over the holidays. It was...
What holiday was that?
The Christmas.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. All right. Just be clear.
Over the Christmas holidays.
Yeah.
I started hearing stuff about, hey, it doesn't look good, and things, they want to make changes, and I didn't know what they were talking
about. Who was telling you this?
Just different people at Saturday Night Live, you know?
You had heard rumors that there were going to be changes, it doesn't look good.
And so then I was hanging out and stuff, and then the guys go, hey, man, you got to call this dude Don Ohlmeyer, who's the president of the network.
Don Ohlmeyer is the president of NBC.
Right.
And they're telling you, you've got to call Don Ohlmeyer.
Right.
So when you called Don Ohlmeyer, what did he say?
He said he didn't want me to do an update.
Why?
Because he doesn't think I was funny.
He said that to your face?
Yeah.
I don't think you're
on
funny.
On the phone right. He did this?
He said to me that update is like dragging down the show and that...
Really?
That, yeah.
Gee, I must not know anything.
Well, baby,
and then what did you do? Did you yell at him? Did you say anything to him or did you just hang up?
No, I just said, listen... if I'm unfunny, then he said, you know, I wanted to, you know, I want you to be better. And I go, well, I can't because if I'm not funny.
How can I make myself funny?
An unfunny guy can't be funny.
Who will be the news guy now on Saturday Night Live?
I think maybe it's Colin.
That's what it says in the newspaper.
Yeah.
And it says you agreed to be replaced.
Well, that sure is hell.
That's not true.
No,
you love doing the weekend update. Sure, and be serious.
Yeah, it's the thing I like doing the best. That's the only thing I like doing.
I know. I love you doing
it.
It's fun. And you're accepting this?
You don't, what do you mean?
And are you now with Saturday Night Live in any other capacity, or have you quit?
No, I got to keep doing sketches.
Is that right?
And you don't want to do sketches.
Sometimes they write in sketches, and this is what they didn't do when I was on Update, because I had Update.
Yeah.
But all of a sudden, you got to be like, you know, you got to be like the scientist that discovered Monkey Boy or something.
I know, I know. Yeah, you're suddenly, you're the scientist who discovered
Monkey Boy.
Yeah, right. You're being a straight man to Monkey Boy.
Right.
I'm with you on this.
Don Ohlmeyer is a good man, though. I mean,
man, don't kiss the corporate ass that just fired you.
Nah, he just seems like he stuck by his OJ. You know, he stuck by his friend.
Right? There you go. Yeah, Don Ohlmeyer's the guy who stuck by OJ. This is a really good way of saying he's a good guy.
No, he is a good
guy. You are an amazingly calculated man. Oh,
you know,
man.
You know this guy, Milos Forman.
Yeah, he's a big director.
So he saw me on Saturday Night Live, so he got the idea I was smart.
I always thought that.
Everybody always thought that.
Because I'm reading the news and shit like that. So he's come to that. We go out, we'll eat at Nobu and some shit, right? And so I go with him. So it's me, him, and two guys from two foreigners.
Right.
And so these guys know everything, you know? And so they're like, what about the situation in the Balkans or something like that?
Yeah, you're the newsman.
And I just kind of play along, like, by repeating what they'd said three sentences ago.
Right, yeah.
And so anyways, he goes, I put you in the movie, man. I need a guy to... And he was going to give me a big part.
Right.
So I was like, no, don't do that. Like, I can't act. And he's like, don't worry about it. I go, seriously, Milos, I don't want you to give me a big part. So he's like, what do you want? I go, give me a small part. That'd be cool. So he made me a reporter, right, in this People versus Larry Flint.
Right, okay. Yes.
Yeah. I played one of the people.
Right.
So
originally, I think it sounds like you were about to be Larry Flint.
Flint.
Right.
Oh my God.
Bam, Larry Flint.
So we go to we do the movie, right? And and I'm a reporter, you know. So he goes, you know, you drive up and get out of the car and run in. I go, well, I can't drive. He goes, oh. So he goes, okay, a cab will drive you. So it doesn't make sense. Like, right. A reporter is in a cab. So we do the scene. It's me and Larry Flint, you know. Me and Woody Harrelson.
Yeah.
So then, anyways, Woody Harrelson's really cool. And fucking actors, man, when they're really good, it's like something different.
Right.
You know? Because I'm just waiting for the other fucker to stop talking and hope to God I remember
my
lines.
You're not even paying attention.
No, I'm just hoping to remember my words. So anyways, fucking what's his name? Woody Harrelson asked me if I want a beer, you know?
Mm-hmm.
He goes, you want a beer? I go, no, it's cool. I don't drink, you know? He goes, you don't want a beer? I go, no, I don't drink, but thanks, man. And then I go, you drink? Like, I thought you just smoked weed and all that shit. And then all of a sudden, Milos Forman goes, cut! What the fuck is going on? Like, we were in the movie.
You didn't know.
No.
You thought he was talking to you.
Because he was looking at me and talking like a regular person. There was nothing fake about it.
You went to do some college show.
Yeah.
And you go out there, and they say you're so drunk, you can't get through the show.
Yeah.
Wow. Right.
Is that true?
No, that's not true.
I believe that.
It certainly doesn't make any sense.
No, I don't drink very much.
You don't drink at all?
No, hardly ever.
So what happened?
Well, a lot of times people like on stage will think that I'm drunk. Like, I often get that.
Right.
People go, hey, man, you're wasted.
And you're like Cheech and Chong. They weren't really high. They just acted like they were high.
I think one of them was.
Which
so
one?
Everybody in the college where I went, everybody was drunk. Like, they were all drinking beer in a beer tent since noon.
What were you talking about that night?
I was talking about them being drunk.
He said, hey, you guys were all drunks.
And you know how sometimes, like, you say to a drunk guy that he's drunk and he gets mad?
Belligerent.
And there's no, you're drunk.
Yeah.
So it was like that. They hated me, and then
they started throwing stuff at you.
Yeah, and then I didn't want to leave because I didn't want to not get paid.
Right. So you stayed on the full hour.
Well, I stayed on until they finally came up and said, "No, you can go."
But really? it was painful
because everyone's just screaming at you,
right,
the entire time. And then like the girl from the college would call me over, and I go, "What? What do you want?" And she'd go, Do those jokes like you do on Letterman. You know?
Yeah.
Oh, you have a college girl telling you what to do.
Yeah. These people are just screaming like obscenities. You can't go.
Were
like,
they throwing things at you?
They're throwing things. So you can't do an act. You can't go like, does anyone have an answering machine?
Do you ever do a show where it's successful or is it always, always ends up in.
It goes really good.
Really?
It's kind of funny when like they hate you because all you're trying to do is make them laugh.
It's funny, yeah.
And this one guy, when he's walking out, he said, I am going to kill you. Why would a guy be so mad? The security guy goes, hey, I think he's going to tell me like something. He's the security guy. And he goes, why don't you try to be funny? He's like the security guy.
Yeah, well, it's not so easy.
In Florida, where I just was, they have people that, I don't know what the fuck they do, but everybody got money. So a guy picks me up. He's the limo driver, and he's like, fucking guy goes, I can take you any place, man, anything you want. I go, what? He goes, anything you want. He goes, I got my wife. I go, your wife? Like, I thought he was talking about like drugs or something. He starts with his wife.
He could take you to his wife.
He's got his wife.
Says I can get anything I want, and then he goes, my wife.
Don't so, you want his wife?
Was he offering you his wife?
I don't fucking know. Man. But it wasn't. It was all weekend long. I just meet four or five guys, and they go, hey, so this is the wife, and this is the other wife, and how about the eight of us?
Oh, yeah?
Well, they wouldn't say it right out, but you kind of go, what are you talking about?
They want to swing.
You don't really know what the fuck's going on, because they don't come right out and say they want to fuck you.
Things were going really well in the fantasy, you, Nancy, and Shirley, and suddenly Earl walks in.
Yeah, what the fuck? You never told me? And then they're like, well, if we brought it up, we thought you'd say no. Of course I'd fucking say no.
You live in a hot climate. There's not a whole lot to do. You rely on other people, and it becomes like an orgy state.
Nobody told me about a guy come out of a closet whacking off with his half-hard
Earl was an afterthought.
I'm not a fancy guy. Fred, you know that.
Really? I always thought of you as a fancy
My
guy.
My thing is, like, for a sexual encounter or something, I like to lie on top of a lady. Yeah. I don't need a lot of fucking shit going on.
One girl will do it.
I like it.
Hey, Norm, are you married or not? Would you clear that up?
What?
Are you married?
Yeah, absolutely.
But you don't like people to know that because it's bad for your image.
No, I don't want, I've had, like, stalkers and stuff.
Oh, you have had stalkers?
I would be afraid of somebody who would stalk Norm.
Yeah, this one guy, right?
That's a scary person.
In New York, he was all stalking me, and it was my own fault because I was, like, I met him on the street.
Yeah.
And I was you real, hung out with him?
Yeah, kind of.
What?
Like an idiot.
You hung out with the guy?
A little bit.
And then what happened?
Well, he was just this dude. I was walking down, and I was like, I was coughing on the street. And then like five blocks later, he's right beside me with a glass of water.
Right.
He goes, hey, man, I got you some water.
Was it in a bottle, or was it open like an open container?
No, an open thing. I don't
and you drank it?
I know. I didn't know what it was.
Really? What happened?
Well, he was always phoning me. I gave my phone number.
Why'd you give him your phone number?
Just my work phone number.
Oh, dear.
Oh, yeah, so.
So anyways, 6 months passed. I'm in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm walking down the street, and that dude is there.
Oh, my God.
So we're standing there, and then in L.A., like, there's no pedestrians, so you're all alone.
Yeah, I mean, there's no protection.
Yeah, so I'm just standing with this guy.
Did he have water with him?
He goes, hey, I just want you to know I'd do anything for you. Yeah. And then we were standing in front, there's this restaurant in L.A. called Norm's Restaurant. So I'm talking to this guy, and he goes, look behind you. And I look, and there's this big sign, Norm's.
Yeah.
And so I go, yeah? He goes, Norm's. Right? Like he thought.
There's a message.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I said, no, I just live here. I'm trying to tell him it's like a coincidence.
Right.
Actually, I went to the hospital because I go to the hospital a lot. But
what are you doing there, man?
Well, I'm just kind of like, I worry about stuff.
All right.
But what happened was Dennis Rodman was on the show. You know that guy?
Yeah, sure.
So we thought it'd be funny if he headbutted me, you know?
Right. Yeah.
So he tells me, if I go, don't really headbutt me, you know?
Yeah, right.
You're like a professional athlete. You're like one of the strongest guys, and I'm like one of the weakest guys, so don't do that. So he says, no, I won't, you know? I know what I'm doing. I'll just put my thumbs up, and like when I touch my thumbs, you push back. And then when he does it, he headbutts me like really hard.
Wow.
And I like blanked out for a second.
Yeah, I didn't see any thumbs.
No, he cracked me.
Did you blank out?
Yeah, I blanked out for like 10 seconds.
Oh, because I don't get that whole headbutt thing, man. That hurts.
So I went to the hospital, like I had a headache for like 2 days.
You're kidding.
Wow.
Yeah,
are you like a hypochondriac like me? Like, do you think like,
really,
if anything happened?
Yeah,
right.
So I go to the hospital. I thought I was going to die and stuff. And I go, oh, my head. And so then, you know, you get to the hospital late at night. It's all like crack addicts and gunshot.
Yeah, you
got to
wait
wounds.
A long time with just a headache. Yeah,
excuse me. I got headbutted. Yeah, get in line.
They didn't believe me. They thought I was nuts. They thought I was, they think everybody's on drugs.
Yeah, right. They thought you were hallucinating.
Yeah, I said Dennis Rodman headbutted me.
Go, no kidding.
And I go, no, I'm on the TV. I said,
right. They don't care.
Don't
you do Ed Sullivan? Yeah.
You don't like a guy who does shticky joke after joke after joke.
There's very few that I like, but I love Rodney Dangerfield as my favorite. I met Rodney, man, when I was I made the worst mistake ever, which I was in the fucking hotel, and I loved Rodney and shit, and I was coming down in the casino. I was coming down the fucking elevator, and Rodney was in the elevator. I'm like, oh, my God, it's Rodney. I got to say something to him. So anyways, I'd worked on some stupid fucking thing with this director who said he worked with Rodney.
Yeah.
So I used that as a thing, right? So I go, hey, Rodney. I go, we have a common friend. He goes, who's that? I go, you know, Paul Johnson. He goes, that cocksucker. He goes, that fucker's no friend. And there's a full elevator. That fucker's no friend of mine. You tell him he can suck my dick. I'm like, oh, I'm not his friend. I met him on Saturday Night Live because he came when I did Update. So we have to do dress first at 8:30 and then at 11:30 the show, you know?
Right.
He goes, listen, man. He goes, what the fuck, man? Why am I doing it at 8:30? You know? I know my fucking jokes. I'll just come back at 11:30. I go, I don't know how it works, Rodney. You got to do it. He goes, God damn. He goes, let me tell you something, kid. This was his advice to me.
Kid.
He goes, this fucking TV shit, you know? He goes, this waiting around all the fucking time. It's a bunch of all shit, you know? It's shit. He goes, it's the same with fucking movies, you know? You're in the movie, and then you're in the fucking trailer all the time. That's all you're doing is fucking jerking off in the trailer, you know? He goes, it's all shit, kid. He goes, remember this and remember it forever. Stand up, man. That's all there is. Stand up.
And he meant it.
Then there's a fucking, like, 5-minute pause. He's looking me right in the eyes. He goes, stand up shit.
He forgot. It's all shit. Farley was out of his mind even off camera, right?
Yeah, he was.
You joined Saturday Night Live. They send you to the Catskills to have some sort of bonding weekend for the new cast.
Yes, sir.
And Farley comes running in naked. Into your room.
Yes.
Farley comes right, and he had a tomato shoved up his ass.
He said, would you like to see my impression of a salad? And he poured salad dressing all over his head and started shoving baby tomatoes up his ass.
Wow. And did you think this guy's the greatest, or did you think, what the fuck am I doing with
it? I thought
it
was the funniest thing I ever saw. And then he took me and he said, I have to tell you a secret.
Yeah.
You know, and I was so like, I was saying, oh my God, the great Farley has to tell me a secret, you know, something about Saturday Night Live that I should know. And it was a big, big resort. And he finally found a room, you know, that was, and he, on purpose, looking back on now, he took all this time to finally find a room, and he locked the door, and he brought me in the corner, and he said, this goes nowhere.
Okay.
You know, this is between you and I. Pat is a woman.
You
so
see, I'm interested
so hard,
in that.
You know, I laughed so hard that he would do this for a stranger, you know, and that's why I love Farley so much, and he's so much different than all the rest of us, is that he would go down the street and just perform for everybody. And I'm telling you, everybody loved Chris Farley, the young, the old, the smart.
That's what they say.
The stupid, the people that liked him, the people that hated him.
Yeah.
You know, we had a guy come in and do a bad review on the show about how horrible it was and how horrible Farley was, and, you know, he laughed everything Farley said. Jack Warden, when he first came in to the Dirty Work, I was sitting there with the producer and Saget or whatever.
Right.
He came in and he was like, hey, how are you guys doing? You know, he goes, hey, listen, I'm excited to meet this Norm MacDonald kid. And I was sitting there. It was very embarrassing.
Right.
He goes, I'm very excited to meet this kid. I'm a big fan of his, you know. When's he going to? So it was really humiliating, you know. I had to say who I was, you know.
No,
he goes, when's he going to come around? When am I going to meet him? I got you, you fucker. I got you, you motherfucker. Hey.
See what I'm doing?
Yeah, he got me.
You motherfucker.
I mean, I worked with him on the Norm show, but he'd always forget his lines, and it was driving him crazy, you know?
Right.
And the director, these fucking television directors, they go over to him, and they go, Jack, you're doing fine. He goes, don't bullshit me, dude. Don't you fucking bullshit me. But, and then I'd have to remember everything just in case he remembered the one scene, you know?
Yeah, there's pressure on you.
Yeah,
so imagine you don't remember.
I don't remember anything anyway, so right. I'd have to make sure I remembered. So I remember the scene was, we're watching a hockey game, you know, and Jack Warden's supposed to go, he's playing an old tough guy, you know, and he goes, so his first line is, Norm, hockey is not the same as it used to be. You know, it's the helmets, you know? When I was a kid, they were tough, you know? So that was his opening line, you know? So we start the scene, he looks at me just blank in his eyes. I know he doesn't remember anything. But he's a good enough actor, he thinks he can fake it, you know?
Right.
So he looks at me, he goes, just nothing. Then he goes, Nami! Nami, Nami, Nami! And then he's looking out, he's trying to press me. He goes, Nami, I tell you, Nami. Now it's hockey, Nami! Hockey! He goes, it's different nowadays, Nami. Oh, it's all different with the hockey. Ah, Nami, it's different, different. The helmets, Nami, the helmets! You know,
it was a disaster.
5 minutes later.
Yeah.
I read on the computer that Gilbert said something back at Affleck or something.
Well, I don't, you know, Gilbert is not the type to apologize for anything
he says.
But I think it cost him a lot of money. The Affleck gig was easy. Once a year he goes in, acts like a duck, and he makes a ton of
and
dough.
He doesn't even have to say anything but Affleck.
You're right. Affleck. So,
I did an audition for it.
Did you really?
Did you?
It seems like everyone is being auditioned
now,
for the Affleck.
What did you do? Did you try to sound like Gilbert, or did you try to change the duck?
No, they said, I've only been on like 5 auditions in my life, and everyone's been a fucking nightmare.
You don't strike me as an auditioning kind of guy.
No, I'm the worst fucking ever. So I go in, and then the woman goes, like, I go, I just thought I'd have to say Affleck once.
Right, that's easy.
So she goes, listen, I want you to create a story. Like, that's what I want you to do. Like,
what?
You just think of the duck, be quizzical and funny and then sarcastic and then serious and then sexy. And she goes, just create a story. Have fun. They all say, fucking have fun with it.
No, this is my work. There's no fun here.
So then, like, 3 seconds in, I'm like, I want to get the fuck out of here. I ain't gonna be the fucking duck. So she left, and then there's just me and a guy with a hat. I said, listen, man, I'll just say Affleck and get the fuck out of here. Because, you know, I only got so many fucking moments in my life.
Right. You know? You got a life to live.
Yeah, so it's me, a guy with a hat. He's telling me how to say Affleck. I'm saying Affleck. I'm going, I don't have that many years left.
It dawned on you that this is actual.
This is
like,
time.
Like if a doctor told you had 3 weeks to live, you'd say, God, I'm spending too much time here.
I certainly wouldn't be here.
Yeah, exactly.
It was such a genuine moment when you were the last stand-up comic to perform on Dave's show. Sometimes with the way you are, the way you carry yourself, I don't see you as an overly emotional person. And I was really moved, honestly, when you were the last comic to perform on Letterman. You went out and did a set, and then you turned to Dave and you said a couple of heartfelt things, and you were moved to tears. And I was really moved by that, because I didn't know you felt that way about Letterman, and you were so complimentary to him, and you kind of let down the comedy thing, which I thought was so strong, because when you're doing stand-up, you know,
it's false by nature.
Yes. And then all of a sudden, you kind of opened up as to who you were for real.
Yeah.
And you showed Letterman how much you cared about him.
I'd just like to say, I know that Mr. Letterman is not for the mawkish, and he has no truck for the sentimental. But if something is true, it is not sentimental. And I say in truth, I love you.
Oh, my God. And it was really genuinely moving, and I think it's because you feel like, wow.
Well, also, it was accidental. I didn't go out there with that plan.
Was that? Oh, no, but you wanted to say something to
him. I wanted to say something. I didn't know quite. It wasn't that, you know.
Right.
It was some stupid thing I'd written, you know, that sounded just written and fake, and then when I started to say it, I was like, oh, this is going to sound, I'll just talk, you know.
Did Letterman say anything to you afterwards, after the show was over, or there was no discussion of it?
He whispered in my ear something that...
You want to keep private?
Should keep private. Mm. As much as Saturday Night Live holds memories for me, and David Letterman, although I have no backstage experience with him at all, you know, just things he's talked to me about in between commercials and stuff like that, I always felt so so close. I really felt like they talk about father figures, that he was my father figure. Hey, you want to hear a joke from my act?
Yes.
It's about that whatever happens in Vegas stays in Vegas.
I heard that.
So actually, it doesn't really stay. Like, you can't. It's not like you can kill a person and then leave Vegas and everything's cool. You know
right.
what I mean? So what I did was I looked at that phrase. What it actually means is basically you can go to Vegas, fuck a prostitute, And then she will not tell your wife.
Right. That's exactly
That's exactly what they're saying.
You're saying
not like those gossipy small town whores.
You're saying
back where you come from. I'm saying back at home, they're blabbermouths.
You're saying, in other
they're
words,
they're sitting in the beauty parlor going, "Oh, you're married to Hank Johnson? I fucking shit on his face last night."
All right, listen. We're having too much fun with Norm.
We can talk to him all day.
Yeah, I could go with you all day. You're easy.
What?
Get some stiffs on here sometimes. They don't have anything to say.
Norm gives strange answers. That's good.
The great Norm MacDonald, everyone.
The great Norm MacDonald. The great Norm MacDonald. Norm, you are a genius.